Hello, everyone. We'll get started in just a moment. So good afternoon. I'd also like to wish you a happy Museums Advocacy Day. Thank you for joining us. I'm Dr. Phaedra Livingstone, the coordinator of museum studies at University of Oregon, and I've organized this series of lectures through a grant awarded through this inaugural round of grants that the Jordan Schnitzer Museum of Art has put together this year to support academic involvement in the museum. So I'm very happy to have been awarded one of these project grants. Thank you. Thank you also to the staff of JSMA of the Arts and Administration Program for the help they've offered in coordinating this. I'd also like to thank some of the other co-sponsors for the 21st Century Museum Issues Public Lecture Series. Those include the School of Architecture and Allied Arts, the UO Curation and Interpretation Research Interest Group, the AAA Graduate Certificate in Museum Studies, the Center for Community Arts and Cultural Policy, and the Arts and Administration Program, as well as the Literary Duck. At the end, you'll be able to purchase one or another of the books and have a book signing, thanks to Literary Duck. Of course, we also want to thank our speakers, and we will thank them again later. This series of public lectures is being presented as part of a course that I'm teaching this term called Museum Theory, with the intention of exposing museology students and the general public to emerging theory, practice, and debates in the field. Like other public institutions, museums are facing multiple pressures to adapt to rapid changes. The nature of museum professions are changing, as are public expectations for museum visits, and the perceived role of museums as a social good. Today, Drs. John Falk and Lynn Dierking will be discussing the latest research on the museum visitor's experience. Based on their recent book, The Museum Experience Revisited, they'll take a visitor's eye view of museums. Their talk draws upon the latest advances in museum research theory and practice to describe why people go to museums, what they do there, how they learn, and what museum practitioners can do to enhance these experiences. Just a little bit about our presenters. They both have long, illustrious careers that I can only gesture at very briefly here, but they've been hugely influential, not only in museum education, but in science, technology, and environment, and mathematics education as a whole. They've published and presented widely and prodigiously. They've been key figures in a number of professional and academic associations, and they're currently professors at Oregon State University in the College of Education with the Center for Research in Lifelong STEM Learning. Their ability to translate scientific research into text that is palatable to the novice practitioner has had a huge impact on our field and in science communication as a whole. So please enjoy their presentation. They're dynamic speakers. They are very generous colleagues and neighbors. And at the end, we will have a good amount of time for question and answer. So please do jump in and ask some questions too. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Phaedra. That's quite an introduction. Everything from here on out is likely to be downhill. At any rate, Lynn and I today are going to share with you just a few ideas from this recent book that we actually rewrote. Some 20 years ago, we wrote a book called The Museum Experience, and a lot of people have read it. And finally, our publisher persuaded us that we should do a rewrite of this book, which we have been resisting for a long time for a lot of reasons. And so we agreed to do that on the 20th anniversary of its publication in 1992. And I guess the footnote on that is that the original version of the book was completed, the first draft was completed in 1986, but it took 5 years to find a publisher at that time for a book of that nature. The problem 25 years later was not finding a publisher. The problem was actually to consolidate what was a vast array of research on the visitor experience. Whereas 25 years earlier, there was some research, but not that much. And we were trying to pull together ideas to really give a big picture of this experience. And as I say, 25 years later, the problem was how to pick between all the research and to cull through that to defined what was of essence. Obviously, we're not going to do that totally today, but what we're going to focus on in two parts, as we have our want to do, we're going to sort of tag team this. I'm going to start and really talk about this framing of public institutions for personal meaning making, and really get at the question that I've been posing for the last 40 years. Why in the world would anyone go to a place like a museum? And if we understood that, would that give us any insights into what they do and what they take away from the experience? And I'm pleased to say that 40 years later, I believe that actually the answer is yes. And if we could in fact understand those things, what does that tell us about practice? Lynn is going to really step back and talk more about museums as a societal institution and what are visitors and those as well as non-visitors' perceptions of these museums as societal institutions, and how can museums ultimately position themselves to be valuable to individuals as groups and as a society. Okay, so as I said, I'm going to try and talk for about 25, 30 minutes tops. Lynn's gonna talk for about the same amount of time, and then we're gonna hopefully have plenty of time for questions. So, just some important definitions. Certainly when we use the word museums, we're not talking about a specific kind of institution, we're talking generically about institutions like art museums, natural history museums, children's museums, science centers, zoos, aquariums, that whole gambit. I'm also gonna talk a lot about identity. And identity is a topic that I could spend easily, not just a half an hour, but hours talking about. And it's a topic that a lot of people have talked about. It's a used term that's frequently used, and I would argue abused. We like to attach virtually any kind of adjective or adverb to it to describe everything that goes on in the world. I'm gonna use it in a very specific way, but I think generically we all have a sense of what identity is. Identity is sort of how we distinguish ourselves from others in the world and how others in the world distinguish us from themselves and other people. But the one bit of definition that it's important for you to appreciate, I make a distinction. I sort of came up with this framework of talking about the difference between big I identity and little I identity. And you need to know that mostly what I'm gonna be talking about today is what I call little I identities. Big I identities are the identities that most social scientists talk about all the time. And they talk about, if they were talking about me, they would be talking about me as a white male employee of Oregon State University, an American, and all those great kind of sociodemographic characteristics that would pigeonhole me as a certain kind of person. I'm not gonna talk about identity from that framework. I'm gonna talk about identity more in terms of the multiple roles and perspectives and ways that we interact with the world. So right now, my identity is as a public speaker. I wouldn't normally say, when asked, who are you? I wouldn't say I'm a public speaker, but right now I'm a public speaker. And your identity at the moment, by and large, is probably as a professional audience, listening to somebody talking as a public speaker. That's a very specific role and a very specific niche that you're playing. But that's an important thing to appreciate, that we live our lives within these kinds of very specific situations, and they define how we behave and how we react based on that little I identity. So when I talk about identity, that's the framework that you should use in thinking about that. So, stepping back for a moment, there's been a lot of research that's been done on museums. That's the good news. The bad news, I would argue, is that probably well over 99% of that research has been done and framed within the box. Literally, we talk to people as they walk through the front door, we may follow them around the institution, and then we talk to them before they leave. And virtually all of our insights about people and their relationship with museums is framed within that very, very narrow window. I think that's a problem. The other thing is that most efforts have been made in terms of research to frame our visitors has been framed within permanent qualities of either the institution We talk about our institutions as art museums, and therefore we have art museum visitors. Or we talk about our institutions in terms of we're an interactive, we have interactive exhibits, and therefore that's somehow important. We define our visitors primarily in terms of demographic characteristics. We define them, we pigeonhole them in terms of age or race or ethnicity, and somehow think that gives us some insight into people. I would argue that it gives us limited insight, knowing, again, that I'm a white 60-plus-year-old male, and if I'm at the Schnitzer Museum, does that give you any insight as to why I'm here today or what I'm interested in or what I'll do? Actually, no. So if we really want to understand visitors, we need to redefine the spatial and temporal boundaries. We literally need to push that boundary back in space and time and think about people as being there as part of their lives. And we also need to realize that the museum experience is not about permanent qualities. It's about intangible, ephemeral qualities. It's about a relationship between one person and one institution on one given day. And that same person on a different day, same person on a different day at the same institution can have a very different visited experience. So, took me 40 years to figure this out, but now that I figured it out, I think it's great. And it gives us a lot more useful information to begin to not only understand, but in a modest way, begin to predict what that experience is likely to be like. So the question we all should be asking is, what in the world would make these people visit this museum on this day? Because the laws of probability are that most of those people have better things to do with their time than to be in this institution on this given day. So the question is, why are they there? And the answer is that each and every one of those people is there to satisfy their own needs, their own identity-related needs. And I know it comes as a great surprise because we invest a lot of time and energy in our needs as institutions, but they're actually not there to meet our needs. They're there to meet their needs. So what does that mean? So actually, as I say, identity is this very hard construct to really operationalize, to really grab a hold of. It's really hard to understand what any given person's identity-related needs are at any given moment. And part of the reason it's so hard is that we're not always conscious of what our identity-related needs are. But we act out those needs through the ways we use places and other relationships. And I have found through my research that by talking to people about what their expectations and motivations for visiting on a given day, I can begin to sort of peel back and get some insights into why people not only are there in terms of superficial reasons, but for deeper reasons. That those expectations and motivations provide sort of a window into what's going on in people's heads. And those reasons, as I say, tend to be contextually and specifically bound up with what the public perceives the value of that institution is. In other words, I could use a museum for lots of reasons, but as a society, we have come to believe that museums are good for certain things. And therefore, I share those perceptions because that's what my society tells me these museums are good for. And when I'm thinking of having one of those needs, if I am fortunate enough to have some prior experience that suggests that museums are reasonable places, I might even think that that museum might be a place that I could meet those needs. So for example, children's museums, science centers, zoos are great places, our society tells us, for bringing kids. And they're great places to support the learning needs of children. So if I'm in a role on the weekend of saying, God, I got to do something good with my kids this weekend. I've been a really bad parent. I've been really focused on work these past weeks. So I want to do something good for my kid. What can I do good for my kid? I should do something that will be of value to that child. So I start racking my brain about the things that I could do. I could take them to the park. I could take them to the shopping mall. hey, I could take them to a museum. That would be a good, fun experience. And they actually might even learn something. So I'm going to take my kids to the museum in order to satisfy my need as a good parent. Or alternatively, I could have read that there's a new exhibition going on related to some artist that I love. And I'm going to say, I'm going to do something good for myself. I've always loved this artist. I'm going to go to the museum so that I can experience learning about that artist that I've always loved. And that's a treat for me. But again, I'm using the institution to meet my needs. That's what's really important. But those needs are not an infinite palette of needs. They're defined by what I perceive that institution, the museum, affords. Then, here's the part where we take this 300-page or 400-page book, or however long it is, and the middle, probably 80% of the book, 70% of the book, talks about what's going on inside the museum. I'm going to skip over that. It's important stuff. We all are very interested in that. But basically, as we've learned, people come, they have prior interests, knowledge, they use this setting as a social context, and they're influenced by the exhibits and the labels and all the lighting and all the good stuff that's in there. We know that. So that's all happening. But what's really interesting is that one of the big insights that at least I've gained over the last 40 years is that these identity-related needs never sort of go away. They sort of create a basic trajectory for the museum visitor. And so, in essence, as if I've come to the museum to be a good parent, there may be a lot of stuff going on, but I'm going to use that museum experience to reinforce that I'm a good parent. I'm going to try and help my child have a good time. I'm going to try and help my child find things that they find interesting and engaging. I'm going to sublimate my own curiosity and my own interests, because that's not why I'm here today. I'm here to support the needs of that child. And so I'm going to use the institution to satisfy that motivation. And lo and behold, days, weeks, months later, when I reflect upon that visit, and if somebody is bold enough, as I have been over the years, to ask them weeks, months, years later, so tell me about your visit to the museum, my memories will be framed around those expectations. So what I can tell you, actually at great length, is what my child found interesting and engaging to do. I'll be able to remember the experiences that, as we talked about the visit on the ride home or in the days subsequent to that, all the excitement that was generated that made me feel good about the decision I made to bring my child to that museum on that day. And those will be the memories that I have of that museum experience. Interestingly enough, if I ask that person, so what did you see when you were there other than what your child saw? I don't remember. Those things get lost over time. On the other hand, I could have come to the museum with as part of a social group, as most visitors do. But if I really came to focus on that special exhibition, I'll tell you all about the special exhibition, and I'll remember all about that special exhibition. I'll be able to tell you that I saw things that I've been always wanting to see. I learned things that I never saw before. And as often happens, if I say, okay, so tell me about the experience of your companion who was there. Oh, I don't know, they had a great time. But let me tell you about this experience I had seeing this art. And I'll say, well, okay, but do you remember when you went? No, it must have been a weekend because I worked during the week. So all those other details will fade away because the focus of that person's visit was their desire to satisfy their own intellectual curiosity relative to their own interests. So, basically, this turns out to be really interesting because what it suggests is that, qualitatively speaking, people who have similar motivations, and it turns out, as I'll show in a moment, although every individual has a unique motivation, because they are framed by the affordances of institutions, there aren't thousands of these motivations, there are only a handful. And those handful are common among people. People use museums for similar purposes, and people with similar purposes qualitatively have similar experiences. They not only use the institution qualitatively in similar ways, for example, to facilitate the behavior of a significant other or to satisfy their curiosity, and as a consequence, their long-term meanings are also qualitatively similar. So why do people come to museums? Turns out, I've identified 7 major reasons, but there are 5 that predominate. And it turns out these 5 reasons seem to be fairly common across all museum-like institutions, and to date, they are pretty common across a wide range of countries. There have been researchers who've tried to replicate this work in more than 12 countries at the moment, and so far, the good news is everybody seems to find the same patterns in Europe, in Australia, throughout North America, in Latin America, and even in beginning in Asia. So that's good. So there's a group of people who come to be what I call explorers. And basically, they're coming to satisfy their curiosity. They perceive that museums are places that have lots of neat stuff. If you ask them, what did you come to see today? They're as likely to say, well, I don't know. I'll know it when I see it. But I've come to the art museum because I like art, and I'm sure I'll see some art that I'll find cool. Or I come to the science museum because I like science, and I'm sure I'll find something out about science that's interesting to me. But they're not coming to meet a specific goal or a specific objective in that respect. It's a generic goal. I talked about facilitators. There are an awful lot of people who come to museums, not for themselves, at least on that visit, but for other people, to satisfy other people's needs and interests. I gave you the example of children, but I could just as well, there are a lot of people who come to art museums because their friends like to go to art museums and they like to be with their friend, and so they go to the art museum to be with their friend, and the highlight is when they finally get to the coffee shop and they can sit and schmooze. But, or they're coming on dates, or they're coming because their significant other dragged them there. but their satisfaction is determined if their significant other has a good time, not by their own, not by what they see or do specifically. There are people who come because it's a place to go and the place to see. So I'm in Eugene for the day. What the hell do I do when I'm in Eugene? Somebody says, well, you know, you probably should go see the University of Oregon. That's a big deal. And if you like art, you know, there's a great museum there. You should go to the Schnitzer Museum. Okay, I'll come and do that. And then I can go home and say, I've been to Eugene. I've been there, done that. I would say, by the way, that we tend to denigrate this category of people. But who amongst us hasn't been there? We've all, when we travel, like to be and say, I've been there, done that. You know, I'm in Paris, I should go to the Louvre. I'm in Washington, D.C., I should at least go see the Smithsonian and the Washington Monument and the Capitol, so I can say I've been there and done that. There are people, we'd like to believe that this is true, although in general it's often not very many people, but they are a significant population to our institutions. The people who are professionals or hobbyists who literally are coming in order to be connoisseurs, to satisfy specific goals and to find out specific information that they feel justifiably that museums are places where they can satisfy that in-depth knowledge and understanding. And different institutions attract different percentages of these kinds of visitors. I would argue, again, everybody in this room is likely at some time play that role too. So how many of you, when you go to another city, visit the museums? Yeah, so, and you go in part because that's who you are. That's how you identify yourself professionally. That's more of a big I, to be honest. But nonetheless, you use those institutions to help satisfy and reaffirm who you think you are. And while you're at it, you're also curious to know how they do what they're doing. You know, how do they write those labels? That's a really cool exhibition technique. Maybe I could steal that idea when I get back home. And then there are finally people who use our institutions just to get away, to recharge, to refresh themselves. They like to just sit in the corner and take it all in. They aren't there to read the labels necessarily. They aren't there necessarily to learn the latest thing about a special exhibition. They literally are just there to recharge their batteries. And as it turns out, these are not people, these are motivations. To again reinforce this, all of us at different times can and do use museums to fulfill these different needs. And so this has implications for practice. Now, here's the truth in advertising. I've done a great job of selling the importance of this idea. This does not explain every visitor. It doesn't explain what every visitor does on every visit. It doesn't explain totally why visitors come. It doesn't explain totally what they do. And it certainly doesn't explain what meaning they make. But it seems to explain why a majority of visitors are showing up and what they do a majority of the time and what meanings they make much of the time. So it gives us some insights. And if it does, as it turns out, this has implications then for both education programming and exhibition design, and it also has implications for marketing and visitor services. So very briefly, if we knew more about actually why people were showing up, rather than that they were white males, if we actually knew what their reasons for showing up, we might have a fighting chance to satisfy those needs. It's hard to satisfy someone's needs if you don't know why they're coming. But if you did know, you could actually work to give them what they really want. So you could actually build experiences that help facilitate a parent being a good parent. In fact, you might even want to thank them when they leave and tell them, boy, you were a good parent today. Not that your kid learned something, that's important, but that they were a good parent because that's the reason they came. But since visitors are coming for multiple reasons, this isn't about building different kinds of museums or different kinds of exhibitions. It is about realizing that we need to ensure that all of our exhibitions and all of our programs are capable of satisfying multiple needs. We have this bad habit derived from the history of our institutions, which are these 19th century industrial age institutions, of creating one size fits all. But the public isn't one size fits all, never has been. But certainly today, the public doesn't want a one size fits all experience. The public is looking for personalization and customization. And I would argue this provides one little small baby step towards moving in that direction, because at least it gives us some insight in how we can meet our visitors' different needs in different ways. It also has implications, though, for how we promote our institutions, because it tells us currently how our public perceives our institutions. I would challenge those of you who work in institutions, and particularly challenge those of you who are studying about museums, to look at the websites of a lot of museums. And what you'll find is that most of those websites, particularly art museums, show a great picture of the building. They might even show some of the objects in the building. But since not all visitors are coming to see the building or to look at the objects, you are marketing only to a fraction of your audience. If I'm coming to your institution primarily to satisfy a social need, I want to see pictures of other people like me who are using that institution to satisfy a social need. It's very hard to find those pictures on most websites. If I'm using the museum primarily to get away and be a recharger, I want to see pictures that allow me to see that there are places and times when I can go to your museum where there won't be crowds, where I can have a vista, where I can be left alone. Again, we don't market our institutions to meet those different needs. But interestingly enough, we also don't use this insight to understand this is not only why people come, but this is also why people don't come. Because it turns out curiosity, social interaction, the need to get recharged and get away, to pursue hobbies, and even just to see new and different things, those are needs that are not unique to museum goers. Those are needs that all of us as humans have. But there's only a subset of the population that perceives that museums are places that can and do satisfy those needs. So if we want to broaden our audiences, rather than trying to convince ethnic groups that don't come or age groups that don't come to come to our institution, because they're not coming because they're 20 or not coming because they're 20. They're coming or not coming because they perceive or don't perceive that this is a place that meets my needs. If we use these insights, then we will do a better job, I would argue, of being able to broaden our audiences by reaching out to people and trying to help them build that bridge between their needs and what our institutions offer. Of course, we have to deliver on that promise, or that's not going to be a great gambit. So if we're going to create public institutions for personal meaning, we need to know there's no such thing as the public. They're just only collections of individuals who use our institutions, or don't, as the case may be. Visitors cannot be understood by starting with us and what the museum is interested in what we do. Visitors come to fulfill their own personal identity-related needs, which can vary from visit to visit. And equally, if not more importantly, visitors are strongly influenced by what they perceive the institutions in their society support. And if they believe that they support things that satisfy their needs, they're likely to come. If they don't, they won't. And that's a good segue for Lynn.
So I have spent not as much time as John. He's older than me, but I like to rub that in. But I spent a great deal of my time in my career looking at the sociocultural context of museums. So I want to share with you some ideas that some of which are grounded in current research that I'm working on, and some of which has been sort of stepping back and really thinking about some of my work and what it means. So first of all, just to give you a sense when I talk about the socio-cultural context, I'm thinking about those within group social interactions. As John said, most people come to these institutions not by themselves, although some people do, but they come with their families. Many of our institutions offer school programs, children come as part of school visits, and also we know that all adult groups come as well. Much of the work in the sociocultural context, as John commented, has been done inside the institution, and almost exclusively in the sociocultural context, much of it is focused on within group interactions. Something that I think we don't know as much about is actually the sociocultural context that people enter when they come into the museum. The influence of other visitors, the influence of guides and museum staff and volunteers. It's quite fascinating. There's a little bit of work that's been done in this area, but unlike educational research in schools, it's focused a great deal on teachers, the facilitators of learning. In our field, we focused a little bit more on the within group sort of work. I'm not going to talk exclusively about that this afternoon, but a group of students and I at OSU are trying to carve out a place where we look at some of these kinds of interactions, in particular interactions between staff and families. But the place where I've been spending a lot of my research time and thinking time of late is this notion of museums as societal institutions. And so I want to focus much of my points this afternoon about that, share with you one example of some of the research that's actually demonstrating this, and also talk about public value. So it was great that Phaedra did a great intro talking about our institutions as for social good. There are two big questions for me, and I was commenting about how youthful I am a few moments ago, but the truth is I'm not as young as I used to be. There are a couple of questions that I'm still hoping to spend a little time working on and thinking about. One is that how can museums support the sociocultural resources, identities, and motivations that groups bring to the experience? So this is very related to what John was talking about. It's not about us, the institution, it's about them. And so I'm really interested in further trying to understand that piece. And then I've been writing quite a bit of late about this whole issue of public value. And so I'm really interested in pursuing a little bit further, you know, how can museums be of value to individuals, to groups, and to society, in particular, framing their activities within the fabric of people's lives, needs, and the communities in which they reside. So I'm gonna be talking a little bit about these, but remember, these are two big questions for me. We don't have answers for these yet, though many people are pursuing them, and some people in this room, in fact, so. I think the key to understanding, it's key to understand museums as societal institutions. John was talking earlier a great deal about people who visit, but I think there's so much more we need to understand about why people don't visit. And I think the notion of people not understanding the museum affordances is a really interesting idea to play around with. I'll be honest too, I've been pushing on John that his focus is a great deal on individuals, which is wonderful, but I'm really interested in that whole notion of sociocultural identity needs as well. So that's another area worthy of pursuit. But as we know, and John laid out very well for us, personal needs vary. But the other thing that varies is what people know about our institutions and what they know about whether museums might meet their needs. So again, it fits into that affordances idea. We also know, if we think about museums as societal institutions, that there are the collective needs of communities and societies. So there's this feeling that these are important institutions. These institutions preserve heritage, preserve objects that we feel are important. And actually very early in museums' history, but unfortunately I think we've lost a little sight of this, there's this notion that the role of institutions like museums are about educating citizens in a democratic society, this notion that these were institutions that were open to all people and that would give people opportunities to have these experiences. And then something that I think is quite fascinating too is people's perceptions of these institutions are also in our media-rich lives shaped by television, by books, and certainly by film. You know, if you think about movies, I mean, if you think about Night at the Museum, there was a whole host of assumptions, values, and ideas about what a museum is. And it's been fascinating to me to see how museums responded to that movie. I mean, some had sleep-ins and invited people to come to the museum and watch the film and now will enliven the experience, and others tried to pretend like the institution didn't exist. I mean, the film didn't exist. I think also a piece we need to add here is the whole role of social media. I was looking for photos of Oregon institutions in preparation for this talk today, and you know, found as many links to TripAdvisor as I did actually to the museum. And it was quite interesting to go through and look at some of those reviews. People are talking about these institutions. They're telling others whether it's a good place to visit. You know, they're probably speaking from their own identity-related motivation, but they're saying whether this is a great place to take your children, or this is a great place to get away and recharge. So that's another really important element that's shaping our perception. And this view isn't that surprising. I mean, we know that people grow up in a cultural milieu, and that milieu influences our language, our thought, and our customs. In the West, because I think it's important to acknowledge that museums initially were very much a Western idea, museums were created to preserve what was deemed as valuable and worthy of caring for, but I put in parentheses, by some. And of course, as I said, also they played educational roles. There was a feeling that these things that we were preserving, these objects, these ideas, were worthy of seeing and learning about. And as we know in the history of our institutions, some people were invited to experience these objects and tools and ideas, and some were not. I will say that I think this is a field that in the last 10 to 20 years has really worried greatly about this whole issue of who's visiting and who's not visiting. But I think we've tended to still look at it from the museum view out, instead of standing out in the community and looking in. So because we've done that, we tend to forget that varied cultures and backgrounds view museums very differently, depending upon their experience with the institutions, depending upon their background. In some, we know here in the States we have a growing number of people who are immigrants. Do they have museums in their native countries? If they do have museums, were they invited to participate in these museums? So there's layers to this sociocultural context. For those who visit, we know these views greatly affect their satisfaction. And of course, this is another layer that complicates this, is that, you know, there are sociocultural reasons we've created these institutions. And so it makes it very, very difficult. You have to step back and say, well, why did we choose those objects? And why have we privileged certain information? And that may be very comfortable for people, and it may not be, depending on their value and belief systems. Museum as societal institution dimensions, I think, really shape, interact, and very much are affected by these personal and collective needs. And they're key to understanding why only some people visit our institutions and really see them as places for personal meaning making and identity building. And I think they shape the ideas of whether museums are for them, can meet their needs, and if so, what they have to offer them. And then I would say, or whether museums are in a position to do so. So I want to transition from these ideas and talk a little bit about public value, and then share with you an example of a study I'm finishing up where, fortunately, we're seeing some real outcomes that would suggest being impactful in people's lives. So first of all, I want to be clear when I talk about public value, what I mean by that. And what I'm really thinking about is strategic impact for and with a community. rather than thinking about institutional impact. And I'll say this is really difficult. Our funders, even, you know, many of the benchmarks often are, they're set up and created by saying to this institution, you know, what are you accomplishing? So in some ways, it's not even the institutions themselves that need to change. We really need to be thinking societally. How do we really try to understand what's happening? Public value also means that you're fully connected to the fabric of the community and its needs. An example I'll give you, you know, the institutional perspective can say, well, it's really important to this community to have a healthy, vital museum. And it was really interesting. I was at a leadership meeting when the economic downturn started. And I was with a group of CEOs from science centers and science museums, and they were very concerned about what's going to happen to us. What about us? And actually, interestingly, this leadership program was focused on learning how to be necessary in one's community rather than being just a nicety. And one of the facilitators actually said to the group, you know, I just want to point out that what you're talking about right now is about your institution surviving in a tumultuous time. People live in your community. They're concerned about this economic downturn. What is your institution going to do to support people's concerns about these economic times? So it was a really interesting moment. Because in a sense, having a healthy, vital museum is a means toward accomplishing public value, but it's not the public value itself. So you might say, well, why now? You know, isn't the good works of museums a given? And I think, you know, in some ways this question is, all of us in this room know that currently everything, all we've heard about the last few weeks is sequestering. We know that good work alone, particularly if we don't have evidence for it, is making ourselves in a, you know, putting the museums in a really difficult place. But I think there are a number of reasons why it's really important to do this. I think that, and it goes back to what I said a few moments ago, that our institutions in many ways, particularly the educational focus of them, was created with very populist notions behind it. George Hine has a new book sort of talking about this whole history of our institutions. And I think we've gone a bit astray. We've sort of forgot what our center and our focus is. So I think we really need to refocus and return to core values and to our missions, but our missions that are about people rather than about, you know, our stuff. I think also, as I just said, we are really being asked to concretely demonstrate our value and sustainability. And I think the elephant in the room really is that museums may not be as relevant as we'd all like to think they are. And that's the really difficult challenge. So the reality is, you know, that as well-intentioned as our goals are, many of our institutions, and sometimes just because where our institutions are situated within our society, approach people from a position of power and a position often of self-preservation. And that makes it really tough. But I really think that there's an opportunity for museums to work collaboratively for and with citizens to create, you know, more valuable, more empowering activities that actually meet community needs rather than presuming what the community needs, or presuming that what the community needs is this healthy, vital institution. So how do you plan for this kind of public value? I mean, probably one of the most important questions to ask is, how will the community be different because your museum exists? I sometimes say, if your museum closed tomorrow, would anyone notice? Would there be people out on the streets saying, we can't do this, we can't close museums? That's an extreme example, but I think really trying to think, how important are we to the fabric of the community? So, you know, who are our primary audiences and why? Really visiting that. What specific needs or wants does our audience have? How do we know? Have the right people been involved in planning from the outset? Particularly, I would say, in work where we're trying to reach new audiences or people who have not historically used museums. How do we find out and understand where they're coming from? How will the audience benefit from the activities, and really benefit, and thinking broadly about benefits, thinking about John's identity-related motivations? You know, are there benefits for facilitators? Are there benefits for explorers? And then how will the community as a whole benefit from these activities, and how will you know? Again, there's been some effort in this area, but often the tack taken was an economic issue. So there was a whole effort over, you know, the last decade to say, well, this museum is an economic, you know, important part of the community, and if we take it out, what's going to happen economically? It hasn't worked as a very effective argument, and so I think that there's need for us to think in a slightly different manner. Once again, I think that we really need to frame our work within the fabric of the community and institution, and there needs to be buy-in from the top down to ensure that there's, you know, that there's a focus still on the mission. And I think both John and I feel strongly when we talk about taking a visitor perspective, it's not saying that you as an institution don't also have needs, have mission, have goals. It's trying to better build a bridge between your mission, your needs, and the mission and the goals and needs of visitors. Something that can be really useful is developing a theory of change, often called a logic model, where you really think about who's the audience, you know, what are we doing for them, what is our output, which often is the thing called the exhibit or the program, and then what's the outcome, what's the actual impact of doing that work. While also, I think, looking inward and trying to really be true to that sense of values, habits of mind, and this notion of being innovative. I mean, people do feel like our institutions societally are doing interesting work. They are seen as innovative places. So how can we really build on that? And then I think an important part of all of this is assessing our progress in our day-to-day activities so that we actually are always going back and looking at that theory of change and saying, are we still moving toward it? With the understanding that one thing we may learn is that actually there are different goals than we originally started out. So we don't want to be so set in our ways that we can't be flexible and open. So I want to share with you one example And I need to be honest, this project is not entirely museum focused, but many museums and science centers were a part of this project. The National Science Foundation and other funders have spent a lot of money investing in gender-focused programs for girls with the intention of getting them engaged and interested in science, technology, engineering, and math. And I received NSF money along with a colleague at the Franklin Institute Science Museum to actually see if we could track down young women who participated in these programs at least 5 years ago and determine whether, number one, we could even see any influence of the program at all, and really talk to these women about their perceptions of the role that these programs had played in their lives. And this project is ending up, I'm in the midst of writing it up, and it will be completed actually by the end of March, so really excited about that. But I just want to share very quickly some of the findings that have emerged. First of all, I should tell you that all of the people who participated in the study, and our N was about 200, were had positive, for the most part, detailed and lasting memories of the experiences years later. What was really fascinating is there was no difference in the detail or saliency of the memories as a factor of how long ago they'd participated. So there were people in our study who participated 15, 20 years ago. We even had a few people 25, 30 years ago. Their memories were as detailed and rich as people who had participated 5 years ago. The program and National Science Foundation will be very happy, influenced, and once again, it's women's perceptions of this, but they felt that this program had influenced their future engagement in science. And we very specifically looked broadly. We looked at education and careers, sort of the usual suspects, but we also looked at hobbies and habits of mind. Some of these women are now parents, and so we were interested in whether that had influenced them. But it influenced their engagement in science, their attitudes towards, their perceptions of, and their understanding of science and science habits of mind. And for many of the young women, they also really felt that they better understood what participating in science might be like. And in fact, for some women, that made them realize, wow, this is something I want to do. But for other women, it was, you know, I really like STEM, but I'm happy to be a hobbyist. I'm far more interested in pursuing another kind of career or educational path. But something that was really interesting to us was how strongly the young women felt that this program had influenced their personal identity and development, teaching them about how to know what their strengths and weaknesses were, understanding that they were leaders. There were many opportunities in these programs for leadership. It built social capital and networks so that actually young women felt like, particularly those pursuing a science career, there were people they could call or send an email to and get advice about what they should be doing and what they should major in. And I can tell you more about that if you're interested in that afterwards. And I think something that was fascinating to us, very strongly feeling like civic engagement resulted from their participation. Many of these young women either continued to have a relationship with the program. We asked people, we learned a lot about asking questions. We asked someone how long they had participated, and we were getting answers like 16 years, 10 years, and none of these programs, the longest one was about 4 to 5 years. But they were coming back to be mentors. They were coming back to be on the staff. They were still engaged with the program. Actually, we had a meeting in November, and we invited nine of the young women who participated in our study to come and meet with us and a group of researchers. And it was a fascinating meeting to hear these young women talking about the program. And I think something very important, we did not specifically ask this question, but young women, without being prompted, talked about these programs really filling important developmental needs that school didn't, giving them opportunities to take risks or to go on a camping trip or do something that they would not have had an opportunity to do otherwise. All of these young women, by the way, were from poor communities, and all were from groups of people historically underrepresented in science. So I just want to finish up real quickly, because I know we want to give time for questions, is that, this isn't new news to us, but I think we're beginning to understand better how to do this, that if we really want to reach new audiences, and even better reach our own audiences, we need to be engaging in conversations with people, and we need to learn better how to listen, and in particular, listen outside of our walls. I would say I agree with John at some levels that a cultural, economic, racial, or ethnic lens doesn't entirely help us understand museums and different communities, that for particularly people who do not visit, that those categories actually come with come with a cultural background and history of experiences with institutions, and it's a huge can be a huge barrier. And but I think it's also important, as we think about these communities, and this really builds in with what John said, is that we not think of them as monolithic, that actually just because you're a white, male, mid-60s, doesn't mean that you, doesn't really help to explain why you're there. And in fact, there could be another white, male, mid-60s who would have a very different, reason for being there. So,
Or not,
yes, indeed. So anyway, just to conclude, I really think that to put this sociocultural context together, we really need to be looking at the macro view of where museums fit in to our societies. And we need to be trying to take active roles to change perceptions, both in our community, but frankly, one place we really need to change perceptions is at the national level, really helping people realize that these are very vibrant and very exciting institutions that really are doing things that really make a difference in people's lives. But I think we also really need, as we think about that micro view, to understand that people who visit us, school groups, families, all adult groups, they come, they're a learning community already. They come with their own understandings of one another. And as institutions, we need to be figuring out how to better support those sociocultural needs that people have. By the way, when I was on the website of the institution here, and delighted to see the family backpacks, stuff like that, which, you give people some resources and then they can use them and can customize and pay, they can choose the backpack they want, they can do what they want to do with the stuff in the backpack. So that's the way it is. So anyway, that's what I wanted to share with you. So I think we have plenty of time now for questions, comments, I don't know if, were you gonna leave this thing? Okay.
I don't know if we have another microphone.
Yeah, and actually I would say it might be helpful for people, you know, it's just nice for us to hear your name, but this is going to be a tape that is going to be used for other purposes. If you explain sort of, if you're a museum professional or a student, that might be real helpful for the viewers who are going to watch this later.
All of those millions of people.
I'd say there are studies on non-visitors, but they're few and far between. And depending on, I mean, some of the research that I've done in LA, but by and large supports the thesis that I presented, that they are not coming because they don't perceive that these, it's all about value, ultimately. Often we think it's about price. Price is part of the value proposition. But people spend money on lots of things. Even people who have limited funds spend money on very expensive items if they perceive that they're valuable. The question is how we frame the questions. And I would argue that part of the problem with a lot of the research that's been done, marketing-oriented research that's been done, both on why people actually do visit as well as why people don't visit, have not been particularly good research studies in the sense they've been very, there've been multiple choice kinds of things, and they give people a very limited set of options, which
and they start from the perspective of the institution.
And so the bottom line is I would argue that I would even go so far as to say we actually don't really know why people have lots of opinions of why people don't visit museums. But I think there's a dearth of data, would be my argument.
Yeah, I think also we've made the mistake of dealing with people monolithically. I worked on a couple of projects over the last few years that were focused on trying to bring families into institutions, families, again, from backgrounds that maybe have not traditionally used museums. And, you know, there was a feeling in talking with these families that it was all about price, but some of it was about, in particular in science museums, not realizing that they were engaging interactive places, not realizing that science is about not knowing something. So lots of parents saying, oh gosh, you know, I go into those places and my kids start asking questions and I can't answer them. So appreciating that these institutions can we think they're so welcoming and inviting, but they may not be for some people. And another common reason is that people will say, well, the schools take my children. And that's fine, but some of the research that's John's done and it's been reinforced over the years is that the correlation with adults being museum users is far more strongly correlated with children who visited museums with their families than actually going on school groups, so going as a part of school groups. But I do think I know in John did a study about African American visitors, and it was interesting. The data was collected in, I guess, LA and else in, well, I'll let you tell where it was. But what was fascinating is some of the people had moved from the South and had moved to the North, and they had a family and a cultural history of not going to museums because of segregation. I grew up in Florida, and I grew up in the mid-50s to early 70s. there were very few museums in Florida. I didn't have, my family did not have a cultural history of visiting museums, certainly not art museums. And I really had to work on overcoming perceptions that I had that I don't even know where I got them.
We'll move on to another question, but I'll just make an editorial comment. Just remember that we, people in this room, I'll make a generalization, come with values, and those values assume that people should go to museums. We come with values based on our backgrounds in art or history or science, that people should like science or should like art or should like history. And I would say we need to ask and question those assumptions. Does everybody really need to go to a museum? Does everybody really need to like art? Does everybody really need to know science? Maybe, maybe not. Any rate, we need to ask those questions too. Yes, sir.
Yes, I'm also John.
Good. It's a great name, despite being very common.
And not everybody can see me as white male and 60. But there is one element missing from this presentation, which I think is crucial, and it's related to my identity. Mm-hmm. I'm a museum member, specifically this museum. And so when one is a member, your perspective changes. Don't think about what can I get out of this particular visit. What you think about is how can my individual skills, abilities, and talents contribute to the success of the institution. And over time, one comes to learn that there are other members, and in fact, there are many communities with overlapping interests in the museum. And most of them are pulling together to support the museum. And these people have all sorts of tentacles out to other people in the community. Mm-hmm. And for example, when there's a museum opening, I reach out to my friends and I say, hey, this particular exhibit relates to your experience. So even if you've never set foot in a museum, this exhibit will have something to say to you. And East meets West. I mean, when I was the age of students in this room, that was my time, that was 60. So I can just reach out to my friends and say, look, you know, you're going to go to this, whether you like museums or not. It's all about you.
Yeah, actually, John, thank you for reminding us about members. Actually, I would say that you probably fall into that career hobbyist category because, once again, you're sort of thinking about the institution and thinking about how to make it better. But something that we have not studied enough in our community, and I need to add that to the sociocultural context, is members. There are a few people who are beginning to try to understand this loyalty, this passion that members have, and trying to understand how it connects, relates to the museum. The one caveat, of course, is that sometimes the members can seem, for people outside an institution, to be an elite group, and so that sometimes is problematic. We worked on a project many years ago at the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts in Richmond, and that institution was free and open to the public, but the perception among people who didn't visit was that it was a private club that only certain people could visit. But I think your point is well taken. There's also a lot of work right now looking at volunteers also, you know, which members sort of end up being both members and volunteers often, and the sort of the contributions and the social capital that they bring to the institution. So I think it's a really important point. And thanks so much for being here. You are truly committed.
Yep.
I think it's an advantage that only some people know. And I think it's really important, actually, the work that I've been doing on this research project and a few others, and some research that John finished up at California Science Center, actually showed that particularly for poor families who live in under-resourced communities, these experiences can be particularly valuable because they do offer things that either the school or the family doesn't. And there's some really interesting work. Right now, there's a lot of conversation around, what do they call it? It's such a horrible, it's the what, learning loss, summer learning loss. Yeah, which just, you know, drives me batty. Yeah, but, you know, it's funny that the everyone's saying, well, oh, no, these children, they, you know, they lose their learning over the summer. Of course, how that's a really interesting idea. Yeah. It must be in one of these drawers,
yeah.
I think, you know.
Actually, do you know this story, by the way? Is any this is one of the great examples of how people view the world through their own paradigms, but it's also a great example of if you're looking for a smoking gun to prove that out-of-school experiences are really important, this is a great example. There was this classic study, and I apologize for getting off on this, but it's really important. There was this classic study done in Baltimore, and it was actually focused on literacy. And the assumption was that this was a study that was going to help provide some understanding of just how terrible inner city schools are relative to suburban schools so that we could actually fix those problems. So they had two groups. They had a suburban Baltimore group of children from affluent homes, predominantly white. They had a population of inner city Baltimore kids, disadvantaged, primarily African American. And they tracked their reading scores over initially the course of their elementary school years, but ultimately into high school. And basically what happened, and I'm going to try and draw this graph, but I'm going to try and draw it backwards for me, but the right way for you. So enter into first grade, there's a gap in the reading scores of children from the affluent community and children from the disadvantaged community. But then a very interesting thing happens. They go to school, and they both gain, but there's no difference in the gains between inner city and after school. Then comes summer, and by the time they enter in the second grade, the gap is bigger. And then they go through school, and they both gain, and if anything, the inner city school kids gain more than the suburban kids in reading. And then there's summer break, and by the time they get back to school in third grade, the gap's even bigger. And this keeps going on every single year. And from a school first paradigm, the assumption is, therefore, we need to keep kids in school all summer long, because clearly, then we can equal out these gains. As opposed to taking a more open-minded view, Maybe it says there's some really good things going on for those advantaged kids in the summer. We need to make damn sure that those poor kids have those opportunities, because that's when the biggest gains are being made. So it's not about keeping kids in school. It's about ensuring that all children have a level playing field out of school and have those opportunities. Sorry. Any rate, yeah. More questions.
Actually, there's a project in Rhode Island that is trying to do that.
Trying to do that, although most of the districts are trying to keep kids, poor kids, in school all summer long.
Yeah, yeah.
More questions.
No. Potentially, yes. I mean, there are differences between science centers. So, independent. I mean, so the profile of any particular institution in terms of who visits is, for example, I did a study with zoos and aquariums funded by NSF to really test this model. And we ultimately looked at four institutions intensively, two zoos, two aquariums. The profile was different in each of those institutions. It was independent of whether they were a zoo or an aquarium. And the profiles are likely to change seasonally. We all know that we get different visitors at different times of the year. And so who shows up at your institution depends on the time of year. Is determined by what the public perceives are the affordances of your institution. And so I can't answer that question. I mean, I would guess that there would be a difference between certainly your institution and the Smithsonian's National Museum of Natural History or the American Museum of Natural History, just simply because they get 5 million visitors and you probably get 50,000 visitors, and there's probably, that might affect the profile, but that research hasn't been done, and you literally need to do your own work to find out what that
yeah.
looks like.
Yeah, but I, my very first, well, my second museum job, but the real one, was at a university-based museum. I cut my teeth at what was called the Florida State Museum at the time, now the Florida Museum of Natural History. We had huge issues of just people in the public knowing that it was a public institution. And of course, then we had the huge issue of helping people find it, because of course it's on a college campus. And then, of course, your favorite issue was parking. So actually, you know, there's a host of issues, I think, that that academic institutions deal with that are challenging, let alone being appreciated. You know, talk about societal institutions, you know, where you fit into the university and whether as institutions you're recognized and appreciated, which, you know, we could talk about that for a long time, I'm yep. sure.
Yeah, so there are multiple answers to that question. Let's assume that you look, a good place to start would be who's coming and why do they think that this institution is valuable? So based on that, then you could say, how could I make it more valuable to the people who do come? So then if most of the people who are coming are just arbitrarily, in that professional or hobbyist category. So they really are there because they are totally nutso about natural history, and they see it as a place to support that. So you could ask the question, so how do I make that a really super experience for them? Are they actually fulfilled in that motivation? The question is, are there other people who share those interests who aren't coming? How would I find those people and reach out to them? But we also know that people could use this institution who don't have that motivation. Why aren't those people coming? Why don't they appreciate or realize that our institution could support a family visitor, for example? And we don't get many families. I don't know, obviously, but hypothetically. So what could I do to make that happen? So that's sort of how you would begin to practically use that tool. And you would say, well, you know, how do we promote our institution? What does our website look like? What is the message that we're conveying on our website? What is the message we convey when we send out a press release? What is the message as somebody walks in the front door? Is that reinforcing or not reinforcing the kinds of messages that might broaden our audience or diversify our audience or whatever you want to do?
Was talking with a colleague a couple of weeks ago, Judy Koch. Some of you may have read her work or know her. And she's now working at the Nelson Atkins Museum in Kansas City. And she was hired because there was a real desire on the part of the new director there, who was the previous director of the Barrio Museum, to really reach out to groups that haven't been there, and they have some kind of a innovation grant, and they were trying to brainstorm about doing something a little bit different than maybe visitor panels. And one of the things that they decided to do for a month, everyone on the team said, you know, when we're out in our everyday life, getting our hair cut, getting our car fixed at the mechanics, you know, in the grocery line, being checked out, we're going to talk to people and ask them what they might want to do at the Nelson Atkins. Sounds like a great idea. At the end of the month, they sat down, and they were pretty unimpressed. I mean, people either didn't have an idea of what, or thought they were a little bit crazy that they were asking, or actually suggested things that were in their realm of knowledge of what the possibilities might be. So they said, wait, that didn't work. So the next thing they did is they decided to talk to people in their everyday lives and ask them about something that they were really passionate about. And then say to the person, well, could you do something related to that at the Nelson Atkins Museum? And it's really been fascinating. They've done like two or three programs now. First of all, they've organized these programs in 2 days. When does a museum organize anything in 2 days? They've used the people who have the idea. They come to the museum, they propose an idea, and then part of their contract is that they have to help get people to the museum. So a couple of examples. There was a young woman who Judy ran into who loves to embroider. And she said, you know, there are beautiful tapestries in the Nelson Atkins. I embroider with a group of women and men. And, you know, we would love to be able to come into the tapestry gallery and just embroider. It would be so inspirational for us. And they said, well, let's do it. 2 days later, they had 55 people in the gallery from 7 to 9. One woman even brought a carpet because she said she had been to the Nelson Atkins and she knew the floor was cold. And they had this amazing program. Somebody else, I guess a week ago Friday, someone said, they have this sculpture garden out front, and there happens to be a dog there. And someone said, you know, I am crazy about dogs. Can we do an event where we just invite people to bring their dogs, and people can bring sketch pads or easels, and we're going to do dog art. And they said, sure. Again, a large number of people. The embroiderers, they sent it out through their social media things, and in two nights to get 55 people. So anyway, I think that those are some ideas. And then John actually, one of the UK institutions in northeastern, okay.
Another day. Let's take one more question.
Okay, okay.
I'm looking at the time.
Yeah, okay.
We'll take a last question.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Sorry. My name is Hannah. I'm in Dr. Livingstone's Museum Fairy class, and thank you for your really fantastic insights today. My question has to do with the notion of bridging a museum's mission statement with visitor needs and desires. And this arises out of an experience that I had working at a small museum with a very social justice-focused mission. But the visitorship at this museum didn't really come to the museum, it seemed, for that reason. So I'm wondering, in very practical terms, if you have any examples of ways to sort of bridge those things to meet both the desires of the institution and the public.
You want to do this, or?
You can.
Okay. Well, the first thing I'd say is thank you for appreciating that sometimes the mission of the institution and the goals of visitors don't exactly dovetail. There's a whole group of institutions in our society where this is true almost every day, and those are called zoos and aquariums. The zoos, by and large, are committed and convinced that that they are first and foremost conservation institutions. God bless them, they are. But that's not why most people visit zoos and aquariums, in order to be inculcated in the ethos of conservation. This is always an interesting challenge, and I think unfortunately, there are no pat and simple answers. But it is, as Lynn said, it is about building these bridges, trying to understand where would the intersection between the kinds of interests and goals the visitor has and the kinds and goals that would be driven by our mission, and where can we find common ground in that space. And that's the space that you should be playing in, not the pure mission space, and frankly, not the pure visitor, I'm just here to have a good time, or whatever their goal might be, space. There is a middle ground, and that's what the hard work of being a museum professional should be about, is finding where that common ground is. And it depends obviously on the institution.
Yeah, I think some museums have been trying to be conveners around issues in a community. So maybe there's an issue around public health or around, addiction or around something. And there are some models of how the museum, instead of trying to be the teacher or even the facilitator, has just been the meeting place to bring different people into the institution. And then, part of it is about building relationships. And if people don't visit, they don't have that wonderful relationship that John has with this place. And so it's trying to figure out how can you be a place. A really interesting example, and then we'll stop, was the Des Moines Arts Center. It was about 10...
No, more like 15.
15 years ago. They realized that it was a great place to invite English second language learners and teachers to come and hold their classes. Because what a great space. It was very, inspirational again, and a place that they could talk about. You need to talk about something, and instead of just sitting there and learning, through a workbook. And so, really thinking, what are some issues in the community? I think museums have a wonderful opportunity to help to support healthy, families and healthy communities. I think we should be communicating that learning is public health. And it's sort of there, but if you think about all the research about young children and infants even at this point in utero and older adults, you know, we should be talking about our institutions as places where people can continue to learn and can learn outside, if you're in school, outside of school, and be these innovative, supportive places. That's probably a good place to end, although maybe one more.
Yeah.
Okay.